Hello, my name is Dr. Todd Daniel, and I teach statistics. I hold a PhD in organizational psychology, and I direct a center for research in statistics. You know, it took me a lot of time and work to get to the place in my education where people call me doctor. Now, my wife is a doctor as well. She is a licensed psychologist in private practice. So when we meet new people, sometimes people will say, "You're both psychologists?" And then they look worried. And then they say, "So you must be reading my mind." I spent a lot of time in graduate school, but I've never had a single class on mind reading. But I'm always willing to learn. So I've been getting into mind reading recently, and I've been practicing. So I think I'd like to try out some mind reading with you. Does that sound like fun? Now, I know you're skeptical, and that's okay. You gotta trust me. This mind reading stuff is for real. Let me show you. I'm gonna have you pick a number between 1 and 50, and then I'm gonna read your mind and tell you what it is. Are you ready? Oh, wait. Hold on. No, that's not gonna work. Okay, let's do this. I'll pick a number between 1 and 50, and then I'll project it into your mind. That'll work. Okay, you ready? Okay, the number that I'm thinking of is between 1 and 50. Both of the digits are odd, but they're not the same. So for instance, it could be 17, but it couldn't be 11. Have you chosen a number? Please do so. All right, my number was 37. Did you think of 37? Now, I must confess, I might have confused you a little because I started to think about 35 and then I changed my mind. So did you get either one of those two numbers? This mind reading thing is for real. What? You don't believe me? How could I be lying to you? You saw it with your own eyes. Okay, let's see how this mind reading thing could have happened. Now, on one hand, I could have projected a number into your head. But on the other hand, there's not really all that many numbers you could have chosen after all. Now, 1 to 50 sounds like a lot of numbers, but if both of the digits are odd, well, that rules out the single digits, the 20s, the 40s. I mentioned numbers 11 and 17, which makes it less likely you would pick those. 33 is out by definition. We know that when people are given a group of numbers, most people tend to pick a number toward the middle of a distribution. So the most likely numbers to be picked were 37, or 35, and I covered both of those. So was that mind reading, or was that psychology, or trickery? And why do I start a course on statistics with a lecture on mind reading? I use this example to make a point about science and statistics. There are many claims of truth in the world. Now, I just claimed to be able to do mind reading, and I told you to trust me. But I'm not the only one. There are plenty of people who will announce their claims of truth and then want you to listen to them. However, you, as a skeptical thinker, you quickly begin to notice that many of those people with their claims of truth also want something from you. They want you to give them your money, or vote for them, or buy something from them, or come to their church, or join their multi-level marketing program. Some of them want you to believe that they have powers that cannot be explained by science, powers that allow them to read minds, or give them supernatural psychic abilities, or they can talk to dead people. So how do you separate truth from falsehood? How do you sort the sheep from the goats? The truth tellers from the charlatans. And while we are at it, sorting out truth from falsehood, we might want to ask, is there a universal truth? Are there things that are true for all people at all times, everywhere, without exception? Now, of course, that's a pretty philosophical question, but science still helps us answer it. For one thing, the claim that universal truth exists is a claim, and it can be tested. Or at least, we can ask for evidence. And remember that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. In science, we're not really looking for universal truths. We're a bit more modest in our pursuits. We could remember that science has given us some pretty profound, specific truths, like gravity, and the laws of physics, and medicine, and psychology, and physiology, and we have a pretty good grasp of how and when these explanations work, and under what conditions they don't work. Understanding specific truths gives us tremendous leverage in the world. Of course, the most important reason why we need a way to evaluate claims of truth is because the person who is most likely to lie to you is you. We trust what we tell ourselves and what makes sense in our own worldview, beliefs, or intuition. That is where we need to be most careful. There are many ideas that are intuitively true. It's intuitive that the sun moves around the earth. It's intuitive that cold water freezes faster than hot water. It's intuitive that heavy objects fall faster than light objects. It's intuitive that abstinence until marriage is 100% effective at preventing pregnancy. But then there's reality. Reality is like honey badger. Reality doesn't care about our intuition. Reality doesn't care about our beliefs. Reality doesn't care because reality just is. And reality works regardless of what we believe. So reality is the realm in which we need science. And the scientific method helps us to separate the claims of truth from falsehood, claims of faith from those backed by evidence, claims that work from claims that don't stand up to scrutiny. But before we go, let me do one more mind reading trick. And this time, I'm going to use cards. Now, I'd like you to pick a card. Don't tell me what it is. Pick just one. Now, I want you to really think about that card. Really concentrate. Think about the face value. Is it king, queen, jack? Think about the suit. Hearts, diamonds, clubs, spades. Think about the color. Red or black? You got it? I know what card you chose. And I've made it disappear. It's magic. You gotta trust me.